Hi, I'm Rachel Wall, founder of InspiredHygiene.com. And today I'd like to talk to you a little bit about calibration. We've done videos on calibration before, but we're going to get really specific on bleeding, how we indicate bleeding. So I have to give credit where credit is due. And you know, if you've followed us for very long, that we love building on the knowledge of others. We talked about that in a recent e-zine article. And so I have to give credit for this concept to JP Consulting. I just worked with a client recently that had worked with them years and years ago, and they'd done really great things with their hygiene department, and now over time, things get diluted and they needed to get recalibrated. So I had the opportunity to go in and work with them and do just that. So I know it sounds kind of funny for me to give credit to someone who might, to a company that may be seen as a competitor, but I don't really see it that way. I really value and admire that group for the foundation that they laid in for all of us hygiene coaches and trainers. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about actually one of their concepts, but something that's universal for all of us, and it is, how do we define bleeding? So I've talked before about the importance of charting and documenting bleeding and really quantifying it so that we can give a clear before and after picture of what is happening with the state of the tissue. And as we all know, bleeding is one of the primary indicators of active infection. So with this particular team, the bleeding indicators had become very subjective. One person had a different idea of what was slight bleeding than another person did. And so unless the doctor, for instance, had been with the patient for 45 minutes, as the hygienist had, he had a hard time really really feeling strongly about the need to move forward with therapy because he hadn't seen the level of bleeding and the infection that was present. So what we did is we had them do two things. One is they needed to quantify the number of bleeding sites so that we could really do a before and after comparison, before therapy and after therapy. And two, they had to get calibrated on what's slight, what's moderate, what's heavy. So this is kind of how they defined it and how we really worked this out. This is a drawing, forgive my art, I am not an artist, but you can see the gingival margin here. This is the interproximal space. So the way that we defined slight bleeding was that you see, it's not necessarily just a pinpoint, but there is obvious bleeding that you're seeing in the interproximal area, okay? Moderate, so this is slight. Moderate is when it filled that interproximal triangle. Okay, it was very obvious, filled the interproximal triangle. And then heavy is when it filled and then spilled out over into the gingival margin. Okay, that was heavy bleeding. And there are late bleeders. So when you're doing your periodontal charting, always go back and look for late bleeders, things that maybe the bleeding didn't occur exactly when you were doing your charting. And the other thing to make sure that you note is the levels of bleeding, late bleeding, and also if you do your measurements and you come up with some deeper pockets of 4 or greater, and you're surprised the area doesn't bleed, go back and do some more investigating. You know, sweep with your probe. Use your explorer subgingivally gently to see if you can elicit bleeding, because there's nothing worse than doing our periodontal charting and wondering why there's no bleeding, and then we get in there to scale and all of a sudden it just opens up. So if you're surprised it doesn't bleed, go back and do some more investigating and be sure that you are identifying and quantifying the type and the amount of bleeding that is present. Thank you so much. Be sure to check out InspiredHygiene.com.